So the first song that we're going to do is called Give It Away. And the it that it's talking about is God's love. So God loves us, but love isn't just a feeling, it's an action, all right? So when we say give it away, that means the love God gives us, we don't keep to ourselves. We give it away and share it with other people, all right? And we can do that through words, but also our actions. So are you ready with me? We're going to do it with our hands. And it says, I'm feeling good, good, good in a crazy way. God's love changed me more than I can say. Can't keep it in, gonna let it out. I'm gonna tell the whole world that your love is spinning me around and around. You're gonna spin around. And then it says, it's turning me upside down. I can't believe the way you love me more than I can contain. I'm gonna turn around and give, give, give it away, all right? So let's remember the words. Let's have fun and sing and dance, but let's remember the words and the meaning behind it as we sing, all right? Here we go, give it away.
I'm feeling good, good, good in a crazy way. God's love changed me more than I can say. Can't keep this in, gotta let it out. Gonna tell the whole world that your love is spinning me round and around. Yeah, it's turning me upside down. I can't believe the way you love me more than I can contain. I'm gonna turn around and give, give, give it away. Oh, 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 I'm gonna give it away. Oh, 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 I'm gonna give it away. I want the world to
in the first service, I shouldn't do the really energetic song first because now I'm out of breath and a little dizzy, but that's all right. We're going to do our action memory verse now, and this is from the book of Ephesians, all right? So I'm going to say it first, and you're going to repeat after me. We're going to make an E with our fingers here, so we're going to say Ephesians chapter 1, verse 22. And God placed all things under his feet and appointed him to be head over everything for the church. All right, that was fun. Let's do it again to make sure we remember. This is telling us that Jesus Christ is really the one who is the head of the church, all right? So let's do it again. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 22. And God placed all things under his feet and appointed him to be head over everything. Oh, here's the fun part. For the church. All right, give yourselves a hand. Okay, we're going to do one more worship song. And I say worship song because it's a kid's song, it's fun, but this is for adults too. There are biblical truths in this song that we need to know, all right? This song is called how far love goes, okay? And this is reminding us that God just doesn't tell us that he loves us. He shows us all the time, and he showed us when Jesus came to earth, okay? So it says, you gave up a throne for a manger, traded a crown for a cross, laid down your life for a stranger and for all who are broken and lost, all right? So this song is talking to each one of us, and it's telling us that Jesus loves us so much. He came to this earth so that we could be forgiven, and that's how he showed his love, and that's how far love goes, all right? So let's remember that as we sing this song. Here we go.
You gave up a throne for a manger, traded a crown.
So we're continuing in the Beatitudes. And for those of you who are maybe joining us for the first time, I want to encourage you to go back to our YouTube library. The first four parts are there. All of the services are there. And I'm grateful for Pastor Eversley having really reminded us of what the church is and how it's to function over the last 3 weeks. But today we're jumping back into the Beatitudes and the Sermon on the Mount, and we are looking at the fifth beatitude, which is, blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. Okay, so that's what we're going to be looking at today. So if you have your Bibles, I would encourage you to open them. I know digital Bibles work. That's cool. If you have your notebooks, I want to encourage you to take notes as well. It's just a very good way to get it in us so that we can be reminded of it as we go forward from here. Quick story. By Rudy Francisco, he writes this. She asked me to kill the spider. Instead, I get the most peaceful weapons I can find. I take a cup and a napkin. I catch the spider, put it outside, and allow it to walk away. If I am ever caught in the wrong place at the wrong time, just being alive and not bothering anyone, I hope I am greeted with the same kind of mercy. Now, for some of you, as soon as you heard spider, you were like, that spider's toast. Mercy doesn't enter into this situation. But today, that's what we're talking about. Not spiders, we're talking about mercy. All right? So let's go ahead and read the portion of Scripture, which is Matthew 5, 1 to 12. That's what we've been considering. And then we'll zero in on verse 7. So here we go. Seeing the crowds, he went up on the mountain, and when he sat down, his disciples came to him, and he opened his mouth and taught them, saying. And just a quick pause there, if you would remember from the first introduction to this sermon series, we are appreciating the authority one that Jesus Christ had as God. Jesus is God. And so when Jesus is teaching and giving this sermon, he is speaking himself. Now, obviously, the Bible has been written by different persons, relaying God's heart and the information to people. But on this occasion, nobody was interpreting. Nobody was standing in the gap for Jesus. It was Jesus Christ himself teaching and preaching. And one of the other things that we said right at the beginning is the whole rabbi and discipleship relationship was very fluent. So there would be times that they would be walking as a group in the market or what have you, and there would be some informal teaching going on between the rabbi and the disciples. That was just the way that they did it. It's still the way that they do it today. But when it comes to he sat down, what that means is that we're moving from the informal, did you catch that teaching, to schools in. So this isn't a question of Jesus going up on the mountain and Jesus was tired and the disciples were tired and all of the crowds of people were tired. And so he had compassion on them and said, you know what? Let's just sit down. Everyone's tired. I'm tired. That's not what's going on. When a rabbi sat down, it was instantly understood by everybody there that he's got something serious to say. And it's time to sit, be quiet, don't ask any questions, school's in. And so that is the space in which Jesus goes up and he sits down and the disciples come. See, we miss that in our language, but when a rabbi sat, the disciples knew what that meant. They would just gather. They were following him, but now he's sitting. So I'm going to get as close as possible because I got to get what he's going to tell me. And so this sermon is 2-3 chapters long, but this is how it begins, with that authority. So that's important for us. Because we can't afford just to think that, you know, well, it's just some words, and I guess Jesus was tired, and This is God himself saying, class is in, pay attention, because this is kingdom stuff that you need to live by, all right? And so then he goes on into verse 3, and Jesus says this, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when others revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven, for so they persecuted the prophets who were before you. And so this brings us to the verse that we're looking at today. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. And I really don't know how we're going to move through this sermon per se, because oftentimes you and I, if you've had a church experience, you will know that the Beatitudes are what they are. And then sometimes we sort of check off when we get to the end of the Beatitudes as if it's not a continuing sermon for the next two chapters. And it's very difficult to understand it that way because the Beatitudes are the foundation, the kingdom principles on which Jesus continues to teach and build. So Lord willing, we'll get to that in some way. Maybe we'll do a couple and then, you know, Pastor Elvisley shares and what have you. I'm not sure, but I do know that this sermon is too important just to poke and pick at pieces of it. This is Jesus' words, kingdom stuff, radical stuff, and that's where we pick it up today, all right? Now, when we look at the way Jesus taught these kingdom principles, it's very interesting. Even if you were to pull apart this sermon, there is no better presentation. There is no better exegete. There is no better building. This is Jesus. And the way that he creates and presents this sermon is nothing short of brilliant. When we look at the first four Beatitudes, the ones that we went over already, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. The idea being, blessed are those who are broken enough to know that they need mercy and they need it from God. That was Beatitude number one. Number two, blessed are those who mourn. And the idea is not just to walk around being sad, but those who mourn over sin, They are sensitive to the fact that one, they needed God in the first place, and now they're sensitive to the fact that sin doesn't work in God's kingdom, and they mourn over it, recognizing that they need God to comfort. The third beatitude, blessed are the meek or the humble, those who have learned to submit themselves to God. They shall be comforted. Number four, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. All four of those have to do with the internal workings of a person. What Jesus does now from 5, 6, 7, and 8 and on to the other two and the rest of the sermon, it's more in terms of what it should look like on the outside. But if we only start with what's going on the outside, we're going to do what society teaches is the right way to do it and make it look good on the outside, hoping that somehow the inside is going to catch up, but it doesn't work that way. So the first four beatitudes that Jesus presents, they're building blocks in terms of what everything else should look like based on living a life on kingdom principles. So those first four are really encouraging us to take a real look at what's going on the inside. Don't just worry about what's on the outside. The inside gives rise to the outside. The MacArthur commentary explained it this way. It's really interesting. But follow me through this. Those who in poverty of spirit are broken, just talked about that, they're the ones who recognize their need of mercy, and they are more inclined to show mercy to others. And that's the one that we're looking at today. So beatitude number one, in a sense, is the building block for being merciful to other people. Beatitude number two, those who mourn over the sin, they're led to have a pure heart. And that's the next one. That's number six. Those who are meek, they're more inclined to want to make peace because they understand that they are submitted to God and God's in control, and I want to align my life with the way God does it. So peace is their result because they're not freaking out trying to control everything. And that's the next beatitude. And those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, they have understood that there is no better spiritual diet than God's righteousness. And so they grasp that so closely that whatever comes with living out his righteousness, even if it's persecution and difficulty, doesn't matter. I'm going it God's way. So this is the basis of how Jesus does this sermon. And it's amazing. Those are the building blocks. Starts on the inside. And now we have to talk about the outside. Most people just want to talk about the outside. Right? You know how it is. You have a casual conversation with somebody. I had a conversation with somebody who retold a very funny story. They were in a store one day, and you know how it is. How are you doing? Oh, everything's fine. You know, and everyone talks on that level, not wanting to go into any depth or anything. But the inside matters, and that's where Jesus starts. Now, the theme of mercy, it runs through the whole Bible. I don't think anyone needs to be convinced of that. Mercy is what the Bible's story is all about. And I really believe that one day soon, based on everything that we see around us, the culmination of God's mercy will become much more tangible. Jesus Christ is going to come back, and redemption will be the theme on that day. But redemption comes from mercy. But there's a couple things that we need to understand as we jump into this beatitude. And it's consistent with all of the other ones as well. In order to understand what is being said in the Bible, two things you always have to consider. One is who's teaching what they are saying, but then you have to consider who it's being taught to and what they understood the teacher to be saying. So you can't just take something and say, you know what, I know what this means. This means what it means in my context. Well, we move to that, but that's not where we start. We start by saying, who is it that's speaking? Why are they speaking? And who is it that they are speaking to? Now, one of the things that is so built into this whole time frame when Jesus was walking on earth and teaching and ministering is that, generally speaking, nobody had time for anybody. Mercy was not part and parcel of the day that Jesus was living in. So to us, we can read that and be like, yeah, blessed are the merciful. That makes sense. They shall receive mercy. That's cool too. But if you don't understand why Jesus is saying it, then you're going to miss it. Some of those persons who had the least mercy for other people were the Pharisees and the teachers of the law. And they taught all of the other Israelites and the Jews of that day that this is how you worship God. Don't worry about what other people are saying. And you worship God by doing it our way. And our way is you look and make it look good on the outside. Don't worry about people that can't help you out. You just be selfish. You pile it all up. And that's how you do it. So here comes Jesus, this rabbi. And he's speaking into that environment. And he's saying, hang on, let me teach you some principles. He's already going through the first four, so this is the fifth one. And Jesus is saying, into that crazy, chaotic, selfish environment, let me tell you how the kingdom of God works. Blessed, content, satisfied are the merciful. Now, this would have been completely foreign to their thinking. Mercy is something that you, in a sense, have to take time to do for somebody else. The way that they taught back then in the Roman imperial place plus Judaism, you ain't got time for nobody else. Taking time out for somebody else was a waste of time because your only pursuit in life is to get ahead at all costs. So again, here comes Jesus. No, blessed are the merciful. Blessed are the people that take the time to see what's going on around, to see people for who they really are, and give a hand out or minister or do whatever. That's what Jesus is saying. Many would have considered mercy in a real faulty way, and they would have used it, in a sense, the same way in that time, and even today, persons think about love. Now, one of the ways in which they would have thought about love is, I will show love to somebody as long as they can show love back to me. If you can't show love to me, you're a waste of time, so I'm not going to invest in you. And it was a very similar thought with mercy. If mercy is going to require me to stop what I'm doing and take from what I have to give somebody else, but the person that you're telling me to give it to can't give it back to me, ain't doing it. I'm not doing it. And this was the space in which Jesus is teaching, blessed are the merciful. Now, this seems like a short statement, but for those Pharisees and the like, they understood the critique that Jesus was giving. They understood it, and they didn't like it. They didn't like it at all. Jesus raises the bar, and he says, listen, doing your own pursuit, that's not kingdom principle. That might be your principle. That might be earthly principle, but that's not kingdom stuff. So when you go around trying to tell other people that you live for the kingdom and all of that, you're saying, you're living for yourself. That's not kingdom principle. Jesus raises the bar, and it totally would have shocked them, upset them, and indicted them. Listen to this. Later on in his sermon in chapter 5, Jesus says this. You have heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, so that you may be sons of your Father who is in heaven. For he makes his sun rise on the evil and on the good, and sends rain on the just and on the unjust. For if you love those who love you, what reward do you have? Do not even the tax collectors do the same? And if you greet only your brothers, what more are you doing than others? Do not even the Gentiles do the same? In other words, what Jesus is saying there is, you're getting all excited. You're trying to prove that you're kingdom-minded people and you're the teachers and all the rest of it, but you're doing what the Gentiles do. You're doing what unbelievers do, and you're celebrating that as if you are having a heart for God. Jesus is saying, listen, like, don't the tax collectors, the reviled persons, that's what the idea is. Like, they greet each other. They do that, but they only do it in a click sort of thing. I do for you, you do for me. But you're saying that you, as teachers of the law and you religious folk, you're celebrating that as if that's the standard. And Jesus says, no, you missed it. You missed the whole thing. Now, even in Bermuda, you know how it is. We say it depends on who you know, right? If you need something and all the rest, it depends on. No, there's nothing wrong with beneficial relationships. I'm not suggesting that at all. But if we determine that we're not going to engage in somebody else who seemingly can benefit us back in the same way that we want, then that's not mercy. And that's what Jesus is teaching here. That's what he's teaching. The idea of mercy is doing something with no expectation of getting it back. No expectation. Because one, the person who you're meeting the need of, they don't have the capacity. So there's no expectation of getting anything back. And that's what Jesus is saying here. Another faulty concept of mercy described by one writer is this, says this, "This is the great truth of life. If people see us care, they will care." No, I get it. It sounds catchy. And in many instances, it's true. But that's not a principle. Because you can show care to somebody. You can do that. And they might even just whatever. But the idea is that being a principle, it just doesn't work like that. Because sometimes you can care for somebody and the person can totally disregard you, or other people who see you do what you're doing, they can disregard you as well. But the difference with God is this. That's how the world works, but God works differently. When God sees his children taking care of people, it catches his attention, and he wants to do something about that. He wants to bless us. Now, this isn't no prosperity gospel stuff. This is the principle that God built into how the world works and how his kingdom principle is. He says, if you are merciful, you're going to get mercy. You're going to receive mercy. I will personally give you mercy. That's what he says. So we have to understand that when we give, even though the world might not give back to us, God always gives back and with interest. Always. Because it's a principle that he put in there. It's a similar principle that Paul talks about in relation to, I think it's in Philippians, when he's talking about, he's ready to go home to glory and he's done his work and he's looking forward to seeing Jesus. And he's saying Jesus has crowns stored up for him. And he says, not only for me, but all the others, all of you who love his appearing. Well, when you read through Paul's writings, you come to the understanding that Paul was just a broken man. He couldn't even understand in many respects why God chose him. He was the apostle, born out of time, he even says. But he also appreciated that however God determined to do what he wanted to do, it meant that there were some crowns and blessings that he had in store for him. Did God owe Paul and all of us who love his appearing a crown? No, but it's something that God wants to do. And this is another principle that is God. If you're merciful, there's something that I want to do. I want to be merciful to you. Sometimes when we read this verse, we lock into the only thought, which is it must be talking about salvation. But that's not necessarily what Jesus is talking about. He's talking about a principle that extends past salvation. And so this isn't just about, well, I'm saved now, so I guess that's all that I can expect from God. It isn't. Again, because God set it up this way. It's no salvation, praise God for that. Children of God, praise God for that. But while you now live out the kingdom principles and show yourself to be merciful to other people, there is something that I will do in response to that because I'm God and that's the principle that I want to put in place. Later in this same sermon, Jesus teaches this, chapter 6, verse 14 and 15. He says, if you forgive others their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. Now again, it's very clear what Jesus is teaching there. If you forgive, God's going to show forgiveness. If you don't forgive, God's not going to show forgiveness. Again, this is not necessarily talking about salvation. That's why sometimes we take this verse and we don't know what to do with it. It's a principle that God has put in place from salvation until we see Jesus Christ. And the principle is this. If you don't forgive, you're not going to be forgiven. It doesn't mean he's going to pull your card and you go to hell. That's not what this is talking about. This is a principle which says there's abundant stuff that I want to keep on doing, but there's stuff that you can forfeit if you don't follow this principle. If you forgive others their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. The other thing to keep in mind is that this is, and Jesus does this all through this sermon, this is part and parcel proof of whether a person is truly a child of God or not. Because if we have no inkling of wanting to forgive anybody, then that shows that we haven't really understood the mercy that's been extended to us. And if that's the case, maybe we're not part of the kingdom of God in the first place. So these are some of the things that Jesus is talking about here. Again, in that ancient Rome scenario, the idea of being merciful was seen as a weakness. Like if you shared mercy, you didn't have what it took to be a Roman, and certainly not a male Roman. Like you just don't do that. Doesn't matter. You make it look good, and we're not extending mercy. Today you hear similar slogans, right? You don't have room marching up and down the streets, but you might hear things like, you know, just do it. And the idea being like, whatever it takes, even if it means negative impact on somebody else, you do whatever it takes. Or keep looking out for yourself, because if you don't look out for yourself, nobody else will. Ideas that society will teach us in terms of mercy, man, that's nice, but you better take care of yourself first. But that's not a principle that Jesus teaches. A story coming out of Napoleon's time is this. A mother once approached Napoleon seeking a pardon for her son. The emperor replied that the young man had committed a certain offense twice, and justice demanded death. "But I don't ask for justice," the mother explained. "I plead for mercy." "But your son does not deserve mercy," Napoleon replied. "Sir," the woman cried, "it would not be mercy if he deserved it, and mercy is all I ask for." "Well then," the emperor said, "I will have mercy," and he spared the woman's son. Mercy. It's always something that we don't deserve. We didn't deserve God's mercy, and there will be instances in your life, in my life, family-wise, work-wise, or otherwise, that we come across people that don't really deserve our mercy. It's going to happen. But the question is, what do we do with it? When we look at the example of Jesus, we find a consistent pursuit of like broken people who didn't deserve any of his attention and any of his love, constantly. And you and I fit that same category. So again, you got to remember, Jesus is a rabbi. Pretty close to the depiction would be some of the movies that you see back then and Jesus' story and all the rest of it. And you normally see a very stark difference between the way that the Pharisees and the scribes dressed as rabbis and the way that Jesus dressed. No, I can't say it was exactly the way that it is depicted, but it's very close to how it actually was. The Pharisees would try to look as fancy as possible as a rabbi. And so just for the mere fact that Jesus was claiming to a rabbi, that rubbed them the wrong way. Because I'm like, well, you're a rabbi, but look at you. Like, why don't you dress up? Like, that's not what rabbis do. But this was Jesus. So Jesus consistently would go and look for those persons who were down and out just to show kindness to them, to show mercy to them. That's what he did. That's the example that he gives us. And so for you and I, we have to constantly be reflecting on how much mercy God's extended to us. Like, you know, I think it's easy to get used to church sometimes. It's easy to get used to even the Lord's Supper sometimes. It's easy to get used to scripture memory and even the concept of heaven to be in our home. And God forbid, then praying that he continues to give us the fire for the reality of that. But the mercy that was extended to us, that allows all those things to be true, was tremendous. It's tremendous. It's unfathomable. Like, we can never grasp it. We can't grasp it. The mercy that's been extended towards us. The Bible Sense lexicon defines a merciful person as this: someone who shows leniency, compassion, or forgiveness, especially towards someone who has offended them. That's what it means to be merciful. That's what it means to be merciful. In John 8, incident is captured where Jesus is talking with the woman caught in adultery, right? Assuming that most would know that story, not all of us, John 8. And it seems that even the Pharisees, those who brought the lady to Jesus, it seemed as if they even set a trap for her. Talk about being unmerciful. They literally set a trap to catch her in the act so that they could bring her to Jesus and be like, "Jesus, well, what do you say about this? Because she's guilty, she's sinning, she needs to be stoned to death. That's what the law said." And Jesus bent down and he did some creative writing, which we don't know what it was, but he stated to those gathered that day, the person without sin, why don't you go ahead and throw the first stone? Now, the one thing that we have to be absolutely clear about, even in that instant, is Jesus didn't just give the sin a pass. Sometimes people run with that. Jesus judged the sin, and he said, you know what? You can't keep on going sinning because it's devastating. It's going to separate you. It's going to make things worse. He said, stop sinning. So he judged the sin. But the one thing Jesus didn't do is condemn her. And the idea of condemning means that, you know what? You're no good, and God can't even reach you. Jesus didn't do that. He judged the sin, had mercy on her, didn't condemn her. Jesus showed her mercy, and in so doing, proved to her that she was still incredibly valuable. So one of the questions that I want us to consider as we move through here is, what do you and I see when we see certain people, right? People who are down and out, maybe they've made bad life choices and things didn't work out. And now you see the devastation of it in their lives. Like, how do we see them? And again, it doesn't mean that we ought not judge sin and its devastating impact on people and families. But then do we cross the line and say, you know what, because of that, God's grace can't even fix you? That's condemnation. That's different. I just remember just a couple days ago walking through town and I bumped into a friend of mine just from way back, incredible athlete, represented Bermuda in so many different scenarios, and he got hooked on drugs. And it's been devastating. Just devastating, right? Wouldn't even say really functional. And it's just so sad. I see him, and he's calling out, and we talk a little bit and all the rest of it. But it's just so sad. Again, it's one thing to appreciate that sin can be devastating, but do we, in our humanity, just leave people there and say, you know what? God's grace can't even fix you. And that's, I think, a challenge for all of us. I'm not saying that that's what you do, what I do, what have you. I know I haven't always gotten it right. And even when I meet some of the young men around, usually it's the young men in the area, and they have different challenges, and I try to meet those needs, you know, need some wisdom there. Some of them, just being honest, can be quite aggressive. And so it's just like, what do I do in this situation? Sometimes, I don't know. But if we cross the line to say, you know what? God's not even worrying about you anymore. Like, God's grace can't even reach you. Then we're going to miss the heart of being merciful. We're going to miss the heart of Jesus. Because Jesus, he knew the potential of the power of grace. He's God. But he never shrunk back from it. He would go and pursue people that couldn't pay him back anything. And that's the heart that you and I need to have as well. I think even as we pursue this thing called being merciful, we have to appreciate how upside down this principle is in comparison to the world's principles. It's foreign. Like, when we look at Jesus and what he did, Jesus just being himself rubbed the rabbis the wrong way because he didn't look like them. He didn't talk like them. Like, he was merciful to people. And just by being merciful, it exposed their mercilessness. I think that's the right word, right? Just by being merciful. So these guys, they hated him. And these were the religious people who said that they had a heart for God, but they knew nothing of God's principles as Jesus was teaching them. So you have this situation where you have mercy in person, Jesus Christ, showing mercy, but in so doing, things got worse for him. Because you have a merciless system on the rim combined with a merciless religious system of Judaism, and that combined to kill mercy himself. So then we have a question to ask, like, is it worth it? I mean, like, I want to follow your example, Jesus, but it don't seem like it went so well for you. I'd rather not. In our families, I know that there are going to be some challenges, even with, siblings or aunts, uncles, cousins, friends, where it's like, you know what? You don't deserve my mercy. You hurt me so much. And I get it. I'm not judging anybody's story. I'm just reminded of what Jesus did and what his approach would be. Nor am I suggesting that we should put ourselves back into dangerous situations that can be devastating. But what Jesus would remind us today is judging sin is necessary. But if we cross that to start condemning people as if God's grace can reach them, then you don't have my heart. I'm not saying it's easy. I'm just saying that's what Jesus would remind us of today. And so that's what this beatitude is teaching us, having mercy, having mercy. The basic meaning of the word merciful, as described in the MacArthur commentary, is this, is to give help to the afflicted and to rescue the helpless. It is compassion in action. Jesus is not speaking of detached or powerless sentiment that is unwilling or unable to help those for whom there is sympathy, nor is he speaking of the false mercy that gives help only to solve a guilt conscience or to impress others with the appearance of virtue. And it is not passive, silent, concerned, which, though genuine, is unable to give tangible help. It is a genuine compassion expressed in genuine help, selfless concern expressed in selfless deeds. That's what it is. It's the idea of giving without expecting anything in return. That's just what it is. So it doesn't mean that we shouldn't have like relationships with people that are different. Every person's different. We have different relationships with them, right? You do have relationships with persons where you expect that when they borrow something, they're going to give it back. That's responsible. There's nothing wrong with that. But it's the person who can give it back but still needs it. Are we still going to give it without any strings attached? That's showing mercy. For us as a church, one of the things that we've been doing for a number of years is the Cornerstone Christmas tour, right? Love it. Looking forward to doing that again this year, so we'll give you more info and hopefully we can all get involved. COVID has made everything very interesting, but we're going to, by God's grace, continue to do that. But again, we don't do that to, look at Cornerstone or whatever. No, it's a tangible opportunity to give without expecting anything back, right? We give tangible items and the like. We give the gospel as best we can. But, whether you come to church or not, it's fine. It'd be great to have you, but there's no strings attached. This is just an opportunity to do that. Mission trips, another opportunity, right? Going around to different places. Haiti comes to mind. I remember some of the dental trips that we went on. Lots of money, fundraising to make the trip happen, knowing full well that the persons that we were serving, ain't no way they could pay back anything. But that's the point. That's the point. That's what showing mercy is all about. The psalmist writes this in Psalm 51. He says, "Have mercy on me, O God. According to your steadfast love, according to your abundant mercy, blot out my transgression." In other words, God, please do for me what I can't do for myself. That's what mercy is. It's doing for somebody what they can't do for themselves. And it's doing it for them in the current situation that they find themselves in. That's what it is. And this brings us to today's bottom line. So if you don't remember anything else, remember this. Talking about mercy is not the same thing as actually being merciful. Compassion in action is what counts. Thinking about it is good. That's a first start. Trying to identify what God's heart is like and what our heart is like, that's a great second step, if you will. But actually doing something about it as best we can, because we're all different, we have different resources, and we have different spheres of influence in the spaces where God takes us. But being merciful isn't just identifying something and saying, wow, that person is, it's doing something as best we can for that person. Okay, that is tangible. That could also, be praying for that person. But sometimes we say, well, I'll pray for you. That's great. We should. But can't just pray for them and be able to do something for them and say, well, I pray for them. You know, the prayer should move us to actually do something, whatever it is that we can, to show ourselves merciful. Something to keep in mind about true mercy is this. Somebody always has to pay for whatever is given. It's not just a free thing. It has to be paid for. But the point is that the person who is showing the mercy and the giving is the person who is paying for it, because the person who needs it can't afford to get it. That's what it is. It's not free, right? Just like our salvation, it wasn't free. It was free to us, but it was costly to the giver. And that's what mercy is. So it always costs something. And that's what Jesus is teaching in this beatitude. Now, I want to look very quickly. We're about to close, but there's this psalm in which, maybe you're familiar with it, maybe not, but it really highlights how important this principle is and how serious God takes it. And David writes this in Psalm 109. He says this, "May the iniquity of his fathers be remembered before the Lord, and let not the sin of his mother be blotted out. Let them be before the Lord continually, that he may cut off the memory of them from the earth." And you're probably saying, oh my goodness, like David's venting. What in the world is going on? What did this person do? Well, you might think that, you know, David's being vengeful and he's just like, you know what? This guy, I don't know, he looked at me the wrong way. And David wasn't a perfect person. We know that. But in this psalm, he's not being vengeful. He's reminding God about the principle of being mercy and receiving mercy. And this is what it goes on in verse 16 to say. This is what it says. "The reason that I'm praying this prayer and it's captured for all eternity is for he did not remember to show kindness, but pursued the poor and needy and the brokenhearted to put them to death." So David understands this principle. It's captured in scripture for all eternity. And David's saying, God, this person doesn't deserve mercy. No, in that instance, David isn't setting himself up and over that person. He's going by the principle that he knows well, and it's this. While that person was living, they treated everyone horribly. They weren't kind. They didn't show any mercy. Worse, they looked for the down and out people, but they actually tried to put them to death. So based on his heart's condition, this guy, whoever it was, based on the principle that David understood, he's writing this psalm and saying, God, don't show that person any mercy. Deep. That's just not. I don't know how God resolved that. God's God. And however God does what he does, mercy is always involved. But in that instance, I don't know how he resolved it. But David isn't just being vengeful and saying, you know what, that person. No, he's saying, listen, there's a principle that I understand. And that guy, he didn't show mercy to anybody. And even as we were looking at the example of Jesus and how he would pursue broken, downhearted persons, well, it seems that this person did the same, but not to rescue them, to actually put them to death. And David says, they don't deserve your mercy. And it's in scripture, like you wrote it down. They don't deserve it, God. Later on in Matthew 25, Jesus says this. Then he will say, talking about God, he will say to those on his left, depart from me, you cursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry and you gave me no food. I was thirsty and you gave me no drink. I was a stranger and you did not welcome me. Naked and you did not clothe me. Sick and in prison and you did not visit me. Then they also will answer saying, Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or naked or sick or in prison and did not minister to you? Then he will answer them, saying, truly I say to you, as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me. Jesus is describing a scene. It's judgment day, and there's some people who were going up to Jesus on that day saying, Jesus, have mercy on me. And you know what Jesus' answer is? No. We don't often think about Jesus like that, but this is what this scene depicts. And the idea is that, well, you didn't show mercy to me or take care of people or look like there's a principle here. And furthermore, this isn't just an arbitrary what you didn't do so you don't get into heaven. That's not it. It's more, theologically speaking, in terms of, because this is not your heart's disposition, it proves that you were never part of the kingdom in the first place. And Jesus is saying, no. Not because he's got something against them in that sense, but he's saying, in all likelihood, you were never part of this kingdom in the first place. And the way that you lived your life shows it. The way that you lived your life shows it. Pure mercy is a gift from God. It's a gift from God. You and I, as broken, fallen people, being redeemed, praise God for that. You and I don't have the natural tendency to be merciful to other people. We just don't. I mean, I think there's a part of us that does sympathize, and that's to be recognized, if you will. But this whole idea of putting myself last in order to serve somebody else or to pay for some, it's not natural to us. And the only way that it becomes natural to us or more natural to us is when we become children of God and we receive the mercy that God extended to us. Once we understand that, then we can then overflow that and give it to other people. So it's a kingdom principle. It's a salvation principle, if you will. And that's why in Luke 6, it says, be merciful even as your Father is merciful. There's an expectation. Jesus isn't just being arbitrary and saying, well, be nice to people. I hope it works out. No, he's saying, be merciful. Why? Because if you're my child and you've come to me, you've received mercy in abundance. Give some of that away. A few notes from the MacArthur commentary. He writes this: we cannot have the blessing apart from the blesser. We cannot even meet the condition apart from the one who has set the condition. We are blessed by God when we are merciful to others. And we are able to be merciful to others because we have already received salvation's mercy. And when we share the mercy received, we shall receive mercy even beyond what we already have. It's like this, the cycle of God's mercy. God is merciful to us by saving us through Christ. Mercy. Doesn't get any better. There's no greater depth of mercy than that. But in obedience, we are then merciful to others. Right? God's given us the mercy. Now we understand that he's called us to be merciful to others, and so we do that. And three, God in faithfulness, gives us even more mercy, pouring out blessing for our needs and withholding severe chastening for our sin. It's a formula God put in place. Salvation's mercy is absolutely essential. It's nothing to compare it to and all the rest of it. But sometimes we link every other aspect of sort of the blessing and all the rest of it just to that. But this is a principle that goes beyond that. It's a principle that says, yes, you need my mercy for salvation. But now, as you continue to give that mercy that you received out to other people, there's blessings that I have for you. This ain't a prosperity gospel thing. This is a God principle that he put in there. It's a God principle that he put in there. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. We're going to close. So there's a couple questions I want us to consider, a couple of points. The first is this. I'm going to make an assumption that every single one of us in here at some time in our lives, we have shared mercy to somebody. Okay, I'm going to give everyone the benefit of the doubt. It's probably true. I would expect so. So the question that I would want us to consider is this. Why did we show that mercy? Did we show it so that in time, I can hurl it against the person that I shared mercy to ensure that they give it back to me? Did I do it because when I did it, these people were looking on and now I look better in their eyes? Not suggesting that that's the case, but these are some of the considerations that we have to have. That's the difference between being in a beneficial relationship, which that's fine, and being honestly merciful, which is, I'm not expecting anything back. Something that we need to consider. Something else I want us to consider as well is, how is it that we see the broken, down and out persons in our family, in our community, in our church? Like, what do we see when we see them? Do we see persons made in God's image, Or do we see people who are too far away from even God's grace that I guess I just have to condemn them and say all the best? Something that we have to seriously consider. Final quote, then we'll pray together. In the midst of our corrupt, ego-centered, and selfish society that tells us to grab everything we can get, the voice of God tells us to give everything we can give. The true character of mercy is in giving, giving compassion, giving help, giving time, giving forgiveness, giving money, giving ourselves. The children of the King are merciful. Those who are merciless face judgment, but mercy triumphs over judgment. Being merciful. I reckon, you know, much of God's word is challenging, to say the least. I reckon that this is probably one of those which is maybe one of the more challenging ones. Because it's one in which I think we can, at times, fool ourselves into thinking we're doing it with the right heart. Again, not judging anybody. I don't know everyone's story. But could it be that we're doing stuff only to get it? Could it be that the heart that Jesus had just to go and pursue people, knowing full well that he wasn't getting a thing back from them, is missing from our thinking and our hearts? So let's close our eyes. I'm just going to take 30 seconds, a minute. However any of that message has sit in for you today, just let it sit in for the next 30 seconds or whatever, and respond to God and just see what it is that maybe he would challenge us with. I know that there are difficulties in our families, right? No family has a perfect scenario. There are conversations that maybe need to be had, ones that, you know, you're like, I ain't having that conversation. That person doesn't deserve one phone call from me. And you might be right based on what actually happened. But we have to be very careful that we don't move from judging the sin. First, we got to deal with our own sin. But we have to be careful that in judging the sin, we're not condemning persons as if they're too far away from God's grace. And so my encouragement to you today is this, like, what is that space? Where is that scenario? Maybe it's when you draw. Maybe it's something that happened in the past. Maybe there's some forgiveness that's necessary. Again, not suggesting that we jump back into difficult, dangerous situations. But again, if we move from judging the sin to condemning the person, that's not the heart of God, and we will not be merciful as God would have us to be. And if we're not merciful as God would have us to be, we're not going to receive the ongoing mercy and blessing that he has for us that we otherwise would receive if we were. So before we end today, I want to encourage you, if you're here and maybe there's some resting going on, all eyes are closed, I just want to pray for you. Maybe there's a conversation that's to be had. Maybe there's a situation that needs to be dealt with. Don't know how it's going to turn out. Totally understand the apprehension and the fear even. But would you stand right where you are? I just want to pray. God, help me to be merciful as you are merciful. Help me to see people the way Jesus, you saw them. If that's you, would you just jump to your feet real quick and we'll pray and we'll be out of here. I'm not going to prolong it, but if that's you, God, help me to be merciful. Help me to understand and recognize how much mercy you extended towards me. You've extended more than enough for me to extend it to somebody else. If that's you, just jump to your feet real quick and we'll pray. Just want to pray for you. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah, Lord. Father, I thank you for your grace and your mercy, God. We would not be here if it were not for your grace and mercy, God. The whole concept of church and life with you, it would be foreign to us, but we are here because you've extended your grace and your mercy. We've received it. And so, Father, this principle that you taught, God, As difficult as it is, Father, I pray that you would help us not to try to fake it and give what we sort of conjure up in ourselves, but help us, Father, to give what we've received, which is real grace and real mercy. Father, for those standing, God, you know the stories, you know the situations, Father, and I pray your blessing, God, as conversations are pursued and people are pursued and relationships are pursued, God. I pray that you would bless with confidence, God, with strength, and I pray, God, that they would follow through, Father God, because they want to do it the way that you said we should do it, God. And then there's blessings that come with that, Father. And I want us all to receive everything that you want us to have, God. I don't want to miss out on anything, God. So, Father, I thank you for opportunities like this when we can reflect on your word and let it have authority in our lives, God. And I pray that you will strengthen us, help us as we go forward from here to be merciful, God, just like you are, so that we can receive the mercy that you intend to continue to pour out on us. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Amen, amen, amen.